Jordan family, thank you very much for this opportunity to share with you wisdom in my community, especially on population, on livestock, and development. On my way, when I was coming here, I said, let me compile my speech in English, but in a Maasai English. So today we'll be happy to hear that the Maasai has also the Maasai English, apart from the Queen English, and plus other Englishes. So with this honor, let me share with you that the Maasai people are found in Kenya and Tanzania. We are more than 2 million people. We are found in the arid and semi-arid lands. And because we are livestock keepers, we are nomads. And we keep livestock. But when the people see us moving, they say, these are wandering tribes. But actually, we are not wandering tribes. We are tribes. We are a tribe that was born, was created. We were given 2 feet to walk. And our cows, we are given 4 legs to walk as well. So you can imagine, we have a four-wheeled driver.
So we keep going in there and there. But in Maasai culture, as nomads, during colonial times, we suffered the fragmentation. Because during the Berlin Conference of 1885, East Africa was divided. And in this time, Tanganyika and Kenya was not left. So the Maasai of Kenya were left in the Kenyan side. And the Maasai of Tanzania were left in the Tanzanian side. By that time, it was Tanganyika. People call us Maasai. And people think that we are one tribe. You are right. We are one tribe, but a tribe with more than 20 sub-tribes. And within these more than 20 sub-tribes, we have clans. And these clans are originated from 2 major clans. One is of Loro Kiteng, that's why I said I will speak Maasai English. Loro Kiteng is a clan of a black ox. And another is a clan called the Lodomongi. Lodomongi is a clan of red ox. So within these 2 clans, we have now a big family of clans. And each clan is identified with its values and the characteristics. So when you go to marriage, if you are preparing for the marriage, you have to understand how this clan behaves. The Maasai speak a language. We speak a language called Maa. Other people think that we speak Maasai language. We don't speak Maasai language, we speak Maa language. Maa means I'm saying. And this Maa language is a Nilo-Saharan family, the Eastern Nilotic language. So the Maasais, who are more than 20 sub-tribes, comprised of Samburu. We have about the Samburu, the Cherus, and the Barakuyo. I'm from a sub-tribe called the Barakuyo, who are fought in these regions.
As nomadic people, we keep cattle, sheep, goats, donkeys, camel,
and of course chicken. Mostly chicken are kept by women because they cannot go far because of children. So warriors are the ones in charge,
and they go far away with. I forgot to mention donkeys and the dogs as well, but we don't eat them. Apart, you can imagine now in cows, what we get milk as our traditional food, beef, our meat, malab, it's very delicious, it's salty. And the fat from the milk and also from the meat. So these are the foods, but also herbs. Herbs are part of our daily meal. In the time when I met friends, and I want to share with them some herbs. They say, "What do you treat?" They think that you only take herbs when you are sick. You have to prepare yourself. Because when you fall sick, you don't know if you will recover or that. There's also hierarchy in the community. You have heard of the bones, especially for students who are. I heard there are some schools here, because there are other schools. There are only bone. This is the chief cultural leader among the Maasai's. And mostly this is a position for men because it is somehow a male-dominated society. So this is during the creation. It's other peoples with their position in the community are like Bena. These are the age group leaders elected by their own age group. And we have people called the position for the people called the Imbobil, who are assistants to Legana. Apart from this hierarchy, we also have any groupings. In this any grouping, we have Fayani, who are the elders. These elders are old men called the Fayani, and the Gitwa, who are elders but only women. And the Moran, who are warriors. We have seen the warriors. These are all the Moran, and they are mostly men because it's somehow an active sense of chasing lion mostly, not fighting lion, including those times.
We have also Layok. Layok are the young boys. I can see the young boys here.
These are boys, and we have Ndoye, the girls, the young girls, Ndoye, and we have Ngera, who are children.
In any community, if we don't have children, we have a difficult to work out to make sure that we get children.
Each of the individual positions, in this position, there is a role to perform in the community, including peacemaking, especially among the elders. Searching for pastures worked by warriors, and searching for pasture and water,
and defense, especially defending our cattle, our livestock against lions and other wild animals.
And also herding, our shepherds, performed by warriors and the boys and the girls.
Milking, performed by women, and of course women are busy working at home.
Preparing for milking and other meals.
And also, laborers are the ones who help on performing rituals, and also the warriors help us on performing dances.
And elders help on the corrections. In the, our community, you see, very, in those days there was very few Maasai who were put in prison because the elders would accommodate the situation, correcting all this situation before they taking them to provisional courts. On the population now, as I said, we have 2 million, but we are not sure if we are 2 million because during census times, it's very difficult for us to give an actual number. Because we have a belief that when you count something, you are searching for a negative thing, something that is missing. So we just say we are few. That's the number I will tell you. We are few. So we are 2 million, but we are not sure if we are 2 million. And when you count, you look for negative and not positive, because the missing thing is a negative that can be changed into the positive when it is found. When it is found, that you change. In my culture, when a person asks, how many children do you have? Because I have so many friends. So they come to me, how many children do you have? How many wives do you have? And all this. I say, I have few. And how many cows? I say, I have few cows. How many, 50, 10 or 20? I say, maybe this, maybe or maybe so. Just to avoid the letters, the letters. We have a Maasai saying, "Yo, awesome and got enough. Such a man can drink one calabash of milk." Yes, that is the spirit of socialism. Sharing a little milk divided on sharing of little food was a way of ensuring that each member of the community can access a calabash of milk.
The warrior cannot drink milk alone in absence of other warriors because it is forbidden.
So tulikuwa na amigo, baba, morani hawezi kunywa maziwa peke yake, lazima awe na morani wengine ndio wanywe maziwa wote. Kuhakikisha kila mmoja anapata chakula. Isitokee wale watoto wa mtaani.
Hao watoto wanawatu wenye shida ya chakula. We have a saying that menya omohami ngirina adatua ngitua. The warrior cannot eat meat seen by women. Avoid eating meat at home because it will lead to bad behavior.
So we want all warriors to eat meat that are only far away from home. Of course, sometimes they can stay in the forest for a month, for 2 months, eating only meat soup and all these herbs. And if when you meet somebody from home coming to say hello, this man or woman is not allowed to enter into the meat festival camp. And we used to greet each other in a Japanese way, no shaking of hands.
That's the way it was helping us. Also, we have another Maasai saying, when a man marries, elders make a blessing such as Toiho, Toihiro ondo klimeudo, ta ondo nyeibo, ta jara yangangino, ana, and abaho eleboshia. Bear children, bear on a farm cowhide. A cowhide without horn. Live longer like Mount Kilimanjaro. Expand your siblings as wide as the ocean. Injugunjuba ana inemati. Increase like bees.
That's how we bless the population. So that your generation is a blessed generation. And when we prepare, when we move from one stage of life to another, we have an event of cleanness to remove the past and get ready for them for the new age.
On the livestock population, as mentioned already, that livestock help us.
And I forgot to mention one, that if you have many cows, there's a possibility for me, for example, to get more wives, because it's very expensive to marry in my community. One dowry for one woman is more than 20 cows. So you cannot even think of divorce, because it is a tough seat. For my wife, I paid 20, and it took me a long time to pay all this 20,000.
So you can imagine I cannot even go for divorce.
Of course, she is beautiful, but sometimes you can find yourself in a situation. On the livestock, I forgot also to mention that on livestock, people see us keeping big heads of livestock. But in the actual sense, these are few cows. Because in a family, for example, in my father's family, we are 54 children. My father married 6 wives. And my father passed away in 2016, in November. And on that day, we were given a report of his existence in our world. We were 54 children, and he left 209 grandchildren. And 77 great-grandchildren. So when you see all these 100 cows, 500, 1,000, you end up getting 10 or 5. So this is the situation, and this is should be taken into consideration by the learning community, because you are the ones who are going to be our leaders. And when you become a leader, please spare the Maasai community, because the cow that we have are few. So again, the cows help us to resolve conflicts. When I'm in conflicts with my brother, my neighbor, and so elders come, and we end up giving cows to each other and hand hands, shake hands. That's a way of reconciliation.
So it plays this animal play a significant role in community.
And you cannot identify yourself as a Maasai if you don't have cows. So the ones who are owning houses like these, cars and good education and so on, if they don't have cows, they don't even participate in our meetings. So stay with them in cities.
So this is very important.
And what to tell you that cows are important in the community is that when I met a brother, the first question that I asked him, how are the cows? Not how are the children. The children will come second.
So these are the very important things. So in your Kaikurono issue, I hope your cattle are well. I hope your children are well. Those are the situations.
Now, all this development, this is a very big question that we are still having a problem with. And that's why the Maasai community, during colonial times, the colonizers, the British, they left, I think. I'm not sure if they are around.
They
try to get us to school, and we say yes, English is good, but my language also is good, so I can go to school, but that doesn't mean that I'm going to sacrifice to be assimilated. Why I'm going to school is because I need to speak English. I want to speak. And that is the reason why I went to school. My father
I remember that day when the primary teacher came home. He came to register children to start standard one. And my father said to this primary teacher, "This take this boy to school because he's quiet in the family. I want school to make him talk." As a reason why I took the teacher. And my mother cried the whole day. And in the morning she accompanied me to school, getting a calabash full of milk. And it took us a week, and finally she was tired and said to me, "My son, go to school because it was a choice of your father, because it was not my choice." So then I saw some changes, because instead of giving me a calabash of milk, she gave me 20 cents for sugar cane. So on the question of development, in the Maasai culture, development is defined by a number of children that you have, and number of cows that you own, and how extended family is. That man, when family comes to the meetings, all elders will stand. And this man is much respected. Apart from the Oluboni and the Gwenak and the others, elders also have this kind of definition. By pre-colonial times to the current black administration, we experienced collision between our culture and new cultures. For example, if you go to Christianity, and I'm a Christian, so nobody will blame that I'm talking from my own experience, that when you get to church, you have to listen to the priest. You don't have the space to ask a question or to say, "No, priest, this is not correct," and so on. When you ask is to kneel down to, and all this prayer will go on, you have to, after all, you will give these offers, and so on. But we saw some politicians saying that if you have many cows, you cannot get to heaven. That was a very sad story to us. Because I sweat, I kept all these cows for long, in the sun, in the rain, and so on. And now I cannot get to heaven. And then another question in the church is that you are not allowed to, a man is not allowed to marry many wives. That was a very difficult question again in the community. That what will happen to all these women who are not married? When you go for a single wife. So there's this kind of conflicts, but also another conflict that exists is that there are conflicts between formal and informal education systems, and also sectors. You can even hear in all these strategies, development strategies, and so that there is a so-called formal sector and informal sector. This is a kind of a division that we create in the society, that you have formal people and informal people. And where are you taking them? Are these informal going to be in the... Are these informal ones are going to heaven, and these informal going to somewhere else? So there's a conflict between informal and informal development definitions. Also on education, we have two shapes, according to my own English. One shape is a shape of quantity. You keep studying all books, you receive all lectures offered by professors or lecturers. So you have a bundle of books. So that is quantity. And now, within this quantity,
What do you get as a line, a thin line in this quantity? In the sugar cane, you get something in the sugar cane. In the milk, when you drink milk, you get something. In your Coca-Cola, you get something also. I don't know the name. But in this education, there are quantity and there are quality. So as human beings, what do we want? Do we want quantity or do we want quality or both? So it's up to us. If you can achieve all these quantity things and make quality, it's good. But quantification of education is accumulation of readings and studies of values of books, accumulation of materials, a number of lectures provided, and the personal examination. In most cases, our students are more on scoring goals. They are not talking of the field. They are more on scoring. So when lectures help to be careful of that, because they will qualify on examinations. And also, let me say that according to my English, quality education is a kind of education gained or obtained and qualified to do no harm on humans and the environment. In Maasai culture, there are stages of learning from childhood to adulthood. The stages are Kerashu, childhood, Ilayishu, boyhood, Ndoye, Galhu, Ngitwa, adult women, and Bayani, adult men. Those are stages where we learn how to live in our environment. That's why many live in harsh environments, such as arid lands, semi-arid lands. No water. And so, but again, there are stages such as the Nkepata, the passing of boys to demand for a new age group. In Bolotangale, opening for new age group circumcision. Amuratare, circumcision period. Eunoto, planting of new age group. And on the head, retirement of an age group in 16 to 20 years. And then you become the junior elder. And the responsibility of the junior elders are to advise the community, and then you qualify to senior elder. And when you move from warriorhood to elderhood, you will be told that now you are no longer going to use a spear or a stick. You are going to use wisdom instead. All the strategies now I'm on the last paragraph. On the Maasai strategies, we have a saying in Maasai language that say, Tetamaki, Emudi, Angare, Ve, Lang. Dip your stick in the water to know how deep it is before, even right before crossing the river of waters. Imbogambo and Imbogambo called the land as grass. Treat and love trees as neighbors. Treat the wild animals as neighbors. Ngaina Shulwanishu, God gave us cows. And Imbogambo Ono Shulama, unity among the mad people, was meant to accommodate the needs of the community, includes pasture, water, seasonal migration, stability, from weather, variability, and natural shocks. So, because of time, let me conclude by mentioning a few challenges that as a Maasai community, we struggled for years to resist all this kind of pressures on us. But now we have a difficult time, and we need a new weapon. And this new weapon is education. If education is not going to eat our cows, so let us send children to school. And I'm glad that we have my brother, Edward.
who is one of the students here. So try to balance. If education is good for us, come and tell us that education is good for our side. And with me, I came with a young warrior. This warrior will also have 2 minutes to present 2 minutes song for us. He is trying to balance, to look for a cool ground between globalization and our tradition life. So there is a number of challenges, but I will share with you during coffee times. Thank you very much. Asante.
Habari za mchana kila mtu. Good afternoon everybody. My name is William Moses Ole Singalai. That's my Maasai name, but I'm an artist and I'm doing music of Asante. Mrefu sana, karibia kufikia mnazi. Lakini msani pia, my stage name is Maasai Prince. I'm doing art and I'm trying to balance my culture and the new world we are in right now. Because I have seen that we have the culture. And we're holding it, and I believe we have so many artists in Tanzania, which a lot of them already lost the culture because they actually don't want to maintain it. And what I would like to say is that I'm trying to balance this thing because I see it's going to perish. And I would like to try to hold it where it is right now, because if we don't agree with time, then it's not going to be possible for us to keep it. So I would like to keep it this way a little bit more. A little bit more than, but as well as I'm still having it, it's better than letting it go, all of it, you know? So that is what my music is all about. I'm representing myself as you see me right now.
Yeah.
And I believe that this will go through, and I believe I'll get the audience that I would love what I do. So Maasai Prince, in front of you, everybody. Thank you very much.